Hello friends, welcome to my Sakshi coaching channel. Now in this video I am going to read the chapter 12 in physics, that is atoms. So let's start. 12.1 Introduction. By the 19th century, enough evidence had accumulated in favor of atomic hypothesis of matter. In 1897, the experiments on electric discharge through gases carried out by the English physicist J.J. Thomson, 1856 to 1940, revealed that atoms of different elements contain negatively charged constituents, electrons, that are identical for all atoms. However, atoms on a whole are electrically neutral. Therefore, an atom must also contain some positive charge to neutralize the negative charge of the electrons. But what is the arrangement of the positive charge and the electrons inside the atom? In other words, what is the structure of an atom? The first model of an atom was proposed by J.J. Thomson in 1898. According to this model, the positive charge of the atom is uniformly distributed throughout the volume of the atom, and negatively charged electrons are embedded in it, like seeds in a watermelon. This model was picturesquely called a plum pudding model of the atom. However, subsequent studies on atoms as described in this chapter showed that the distribution of the electrons and the positive charges are very different from that proposed in this model. We know that condensed matter, that is solids and liquids, and dense gases at all temperatures emit electromagnetic radiation in which a continuous distribution of several wavelengths is present, though with different intensities. This radiation is considered to be due to oscillations of atoms and molecules, governed by the interaction of each atom or molecule with its neighbors. In contrast, light emitted from the rarefied gases heated in a flame or excited electrically in a glow tube, such as the familiar neon sign or mercury vapor light, has only certain discrete wavelengths. The spectrum appears as a series of bright lines. In such gases, the average spacing between the atoms is large. Hence, the radiation emitted can be considered due to the individual atoms rather than because of the interaction between the atoms or molecules. In the early 19th century, it was also established that each element is associated with a characteristic spectrum of radiation. For example, hydrogen always gives a set of lines with fixed relative position between the lines. This fact suggested that an intimate relationship between the internal structure of an atom and the spectrum of radiation emitted by it. In 1885, Johann Jakob Balmer obtained a simple empirical formula which gave the wavelength of a group of lines emitted by atomic hydrogen. Since hydrogen is the simplest of the elements known, we shall consider its spectrum in detail in this chapter. Ernest Rutherford, a former research student of J.J. Thomson, was engaged in experiments on alpha particles emitted by some radioactive elements. In 1906, he proposed a classic experiment of scattering of these particles, alpha particles, by atoms to investigate the atomic structure. This experiment was later performed around 1911 by Hans Geiger and Ernest Marsden, who was a 20-year-old student and had not yet earned his bachelor's degree. The details are discussed in the section 12.2. The explanation of the results lead to the birth of the Rutherford's planetary model of the atom, called nuclear model of the atom. According to this, the entire positive charge and the most of the mass of the atom is concentrated in a small volume called nucleus, with the electrons revolving around the nucleus just as planets revolves around the sun. Rutherford's nuclear model was a major step towards how we see the atom today. However, it could not explain why atoms emit light of only discrete wavelengths. How could an atom as simple as hydrogen, consisting of a single electron and a single proton, emit a complex spectrum of specific wavelengths? In the classical picture of an atom, the electron revolves around the nucleus much like the way a planet revolves around the sun. However, we shall see that there are some serious difficulties in accepting such a model. 12.2 Alpha particle scattering and Rutherford's nuclear model of atom. At the suggestion of Ernest Rutherford in 1911, H. Geiger and E. Marsden performed some experiments. In one of their experiments, as shown in the figure 12.1, they directed a beam of 5.5 million electron volt alpha particles emitted from a bismuth 83-214 radioactive source at a thin model foil made of gold. Figure 12.2 shows a schematic diagram of this experiment. Alpha particles emitted by a bismuth 83-214 radioactive source were collimated into a narrow beam by their passage through the lead bricks. The beam was allowed to fall on a thin film, a thin foil of gold of thickness 2.1 into 10 to the power minus 7 meter. The scattered alpha particles were observed through a rotatable detector consisting of a zinc sulfide screen and a microscope. The scattered alpha particles on striking the screen produced brief light flashes or scintillations. These flashes may be viewed through a microscope, and the distribution of the number of the scattered particles may be studied as a function of angle of scattering. Figure 12.2 Schematic arrangement of Geiger-Marsden experiment. A typical graph of the total number of alpha particles scattered at different angles in a given interval of time is shown in the figure 12.3. The dots in the figure represent the data points, and the solid curve is the theoretical prediction based on the assumption that the target atom has a small, dense, positively charged nucleus. Many of the alpha particles pass through the foil. It means that they do not suffer any collisions. Only about 0.14% of the incident alpha particles scattered by more than 1 degree, and about 1 in 8,000 deflect by more than 90 degree. Rutherford argued that to deflect the alpha particle backwards, it must experience a large repulsive force. This force could be provided if the greater part of the mass of the atom and its positive charge were concentrated tightly at its center. Then the incoming alpha particle could get very close to the positive charge without penetrating it, and such a close encounter would result in a large deflection. This agreement supported the hypothesis of the nuclear atom. This is why Rutherford is credited with the discovery of the nucleus. In Rutherford's nuclear model of the atom, the entire positive charge and the most of the mass of the atom are concentrated in the nucleus, with the electrons some distance away. The electrons would be moving in orbits about the nucleus just as planets do around the sun. Rutherford's experiment suggested the size of the nucleus to be about 10 to the power minus 15 meter to 10 to the power minus 14 meter. From kinetic theory, the size of an atom was known to be 10 to the power minus 10 meter, about 10,000 to 1 lakh times larger than the size of the nucleus. Thus, the electrons would seem to be at a distance from the nucleus of about 10,000 to 1 lakh times the size of the nucleus itself. Thus, most of an atom is a empty space. With the atom being largely empty space, it is easy to see why most alpha particles go right through a thin metal foil. However, when alpha particle happens to come near a nucleus, the intense electric field there scatters it through a large angle. The atomic electrons, being so light, do not appreciably affect the alpha particles. The scattering data shown in the figure 12.3 can be analyzed by employing Rutherford's nuclear model of the atom. As the gold foil is very thin, it can be assumed that alpha particles will suffer not more than one scattering during their passage through it. Therefore, computation of the trajectory of an alpha particle scattered by a single nucleus is enough. Alpha particles are nuclei of helium atoms and therefore carry two units, 2e, of positive charge and have the mass of the helium atom. The charge of the gold nucleus is Ze, where Z is the atomic number of the atom. For gold, Z equals to 79. Since the nucleus of gold is about 50 times heavier than an alpha particle, it is reasonable to assume that it remains stationary throughout the scattering process. Under these assumptions, the trajectory of an alpha particle can be computed employing Newton's second law of motion and the Coulomb's law of electrostatic force of repulsion between an alpha particle and the positively charged nucleus. The magnitude of this force is F equals to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into 2e into Ze upon r square, where r is the distance between the alpha particle and the nucleus. The force is directed along the line joining the alpha particle and the nucleus. The magnitude and the direction of a force on an alpha particle continuously changes as it approaches the nucleus and recedes away from it. 12.2.1 Alpha particle trajectory. The trajectory traced by an alpha particle depends on the impact parameter B of collision. The impact parameter is the perpendicular distance of the initial velocity vector of an alpha particle from the center of the nucleus. A given beam of alpha particles has a distribution of impact parameters B so that the beam is scattered in various directions with different probabilities. In a beam, all particles have nearly same kinetic energy. It is seen that an alpha particle close to the nucleus, that is a small impact parameter, suffers large scattering. In case of head-on collision, the impact parameter is minimum and the alpha particles rebounds back, theta equals to pi. For a large impact parameter, the alpha particle goes nearly undeviated and has a small deflection, theta nearly equals to zero. The fact that only a small fraction of the number of the incident particles rebound back indicates that the number of alpha particles undergoing a head-on collision is small. This in turn implies that the mass and the positive charge of the atom is concentrated in a small volume. Rutherford scattering therefore is a powerful way to determine an upper limit to the size of the nucleus. Electron orbits. The Rutherford nuclear model of the atom, which involves classical concepts, pictures the atom as an electrically neutral sphere consisting of a very small, massive, and positively charged nucleus at the center surrounded by the revolving electrons in their respective dynamically stable orbits. The electrostatic force of attraction Fe between the revolving electrons and the nucleus provides the requisite centripetal force Fc to keep them in their orbits. Thus, for a dynamically stable orbit in a hydrogen atom, Fe equals to Fc. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into E square by R square equals to mv square by R. Thus, the relation between the orbit radius and the electron velocity is R equals to E square by 4 pi epsilon naught mv square. The kinetic energy K and electrostatic potential energy of the electron in hydrogen atom are K equals to half mv square, that is equals to E square by 8 pi epsilon naught r, and U equals to minus E square by 4 pi epsilon naught small r. The negative sign in U signifies that electrostatic force is in the minus r direction. Thus, the total energy E of the electron in a hydrogen atom is E equals to K plus U, that is equals to E square by 8 pi epsilon naught r minus E square by 4 pi epsilon naught r, that is equals to minus E square by 8 pi epsilon naught r. The total energy of electron is negative. This implies the fact that the electron is bound to the nucleus. If E were positive, an electron will not follow a closed orbit around the nucleus. 12.3 Atomic spectra. As mentioned in the section 12.1, each element has a characteristic spectrum of radiation which it emits. When an atomic gas or a vapor is excited at low pressure, Usually by passing an electric current through it, the emitted radiation has a spectrum which contains a certain specific wavelengths only. A spectrum of this kind is termed as emission line spectrum, and it consists of bright lines on a dark background. The spectrum emitted by the atomic hydrogen is shown in the figure 12.5. Study of emissions line spectra of a material can therefore serve as a type of fingerprint for identification of the gas. When white light passes through a gas and we analyze the transmitted light using a spectrometer, we find some dark lines in the spectrum. These dark lines correspond precisely to those wavelengths which were found in the emission line spectrum of the gas. This is called absorption spectrum of the material of the gas. 12.3.1 spectral series. We might expect that the frequencies of the light emitted by a particular element would exhibit some regular pattern. Hydrogen is the simplest atom and therefore has the simplest spectrum. In the observed spectrum, however, at first sight, there does not seem to be any resemblance of the order or regularity in spectral lines. But the spacing between lines within certain sets of the hydrogen spectrum decreases in a regular way. Each of these sets is called spectral series. In 1885, the first such series was observed by a Swedish school teacher, Johann Jakob Balmer, in the visible region of the hydrogen spectrum. This series is called Balmer series. The line with the longest wavelength, 656.3 nanometer, in the red is called HA. The next line with a wavelength 486.1 nanometer in the blue region, in the blue green, is called H beta. And the third line, 434.1 nanometer in the violet, is called H gamma, and so on. As the wavelength decreases, the lines appear close together and are weaker in intensity. Balmer found a simple empirical formula for the observed wavelengths, 1 by lambda equals to R into in bracket 1 by 2 square minus 1 by n square, where lambda is the wavelength, R is the constant called Rydberg constant, and n may be the integral values 3, 4, 5, etc. The value of R is 1.097 into 10 to the power 7 per meter. This equation is called Balmer formula. Taking n equals to 3 in the equation 12.5, one obtains the wavelength of the H alpha line, 1 by lambda equals to 1.097 into 10 to the power 7 into in bracket 1 by 2 square minus 1 by 3 square per meter, that is equals to 1.522 into 10 to the power 6 per meter, that is the wavelength equals to 656.3 nanometer. For n equals to 4, one obtains the wavelength of H beta line, etc. For n equals to infinity, one obtains the limit of series at lambda 364.6 nanometer. This is the shortest wavelength in the Balmer series. Beyond this limit, no further distinct lines appear. Instead, only a faint continuous spectrum is seen. Other series of spectra for hydrogen were subsequently discovered. These are known after their discoveries as Lyman, Pastern, Brackett and Fund series. These are represented by the formula. Lyman series, 1 by lambda equals to R in bracket 1 by 1 square minus 1 by n square, where n equals to 2, 3, 4. Pastern series, 1 by lambda equals to R in bracket 1 by 3 square minus 1 by n square, where n equals to 4, 5, 6. Bracket series, 1 by lambda equals to R into in bracket 1 by 4 square minus 1 by n square, where n equals to 5, 6, 7. And Fund series, that is 1 by lambda equals to R in bracket 1 by 5 square minus 1 by n square, where n equals to 6, 7, 8. The Lyman series is in the ultraviolet, and the Pastern, bracket and Fund series are in the infrared region. The Valmer formula in the equation 12.5 may be written in terms of the frequency of the light, recalling that c equals to frequency into lambda, or 1 by lambda equals to frequency upon c. Thus, equation 12.5 becomes frequency equals to rc into in bracket 1 by 2 square minus 1 by n square. There are only a few elements, hydrogen, singly ionized helium and doubly ionized lithium, whose spectra can be represented by simple formula like equation 12.5 to 12.9. Equations 12.5 to 12.9 are useful as they give the wavelengths that hydrogen atom radiate or absorb. However, these results are empirical and do not give any reasoning why only certain frequencies are observed in the hydrogen spectrum. 12.4 Bohr's model of the hydrogen atom. The model of the atom proposed by the Rutherford assumes that the atom consisting of a central nucleus and revolving electron is stable, much like a sun-planet system, which the model imitates. However, there are some fundamental differences between the two situations. While the planetary system is held by a gravitational force, the nucleus electron system being charged objects interact by Coulomb's law of force. We know that an object which moves in a circle is being constantly accelerated, the acceleration being centripetal in nature. According to the classical electromagnetic theory, an accelerating charged particle emits radiation in the form of the electromagnetic waves. The energy of an accelerating electron should therefore continuously decrease. The electron would spiral inward and eventually fall into the nucleus. Thus, such an atom cannot be stable. Further, according to the classical electromagnetic theory, the frequency of the electromagnetic waves emitted by the revolving electrons is equal to the frequency of revolution. As the electrons spiral inwards, their angular velocities and hence their frequencies would change continuously, and so will the frequency of the light emitted. Thus, they would emit a continuous spectrum in the contradiction to the line spectrum actually observed. Clearly, Rutherford model tells only a part of the story, implying that the classical ideas are not sufficient to explain the atomic structure. It was Niels Bohr who made certain modifications in this model by adding the ideas of the newly developing quantum hypothesis. Niels Bohr studied in Rutherford's laboratory for several months in 1912, and he was convinced about the validity of the Rutherford's nuclear model. Faced with the dilemma as discussed above, Bohr in 1913 concluded that in spite of the success of electromagnetic theory in explaining large-scale phenomena, it could not be applied to the processes at the atomic scale. It became clear that a fairly radical departure from the established principles of the classical mechanics and the electromagnetism would be needed to understand the structure of atoms and the relation of atomic structure to atomic spectra. Bohr combined classical and early quantum concepts and gave this theory in the form of the three postulates. And these are, first is Bohr's first postulate was that an electron in an atom could revolve in a certain stable orbits without the emission of radiant energy, contrary to the predictions of the electromagnetic theory. According to this postulate, each atom has a certain definite stable states in which it can exist, and each possible state has a definite total energy. These are called stationary states of the atom. 2. Bohr's second postulate defines these stable orbits. This postulate states that the electron revolves around the nucleus only in those orbits for which the angular momentum is some integral multiple of the h by 2 pi, where h is the Planck's constant, that is equals to 6.6 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule second. Thus, the angular momentum L of the orbiting electron is quantized, that is L equals to nh by 2 pi. 3. Bohr's third postulate incorporated into atomic theory the early quantum concepts that had been developed by Planck and Einstein. It states that an electron might make a transition from one of its specified non-radiating orbits to other of the lower energy. When it does so, a photon is emitted having energy equal to the energy difference between the initial and the final states. The frequency of the emitted photon is then given by h mu equals to e initial minus e final, where e I and e f are the energies of the initial and the final states, and e initial is greater than the e final. For a hydrogen atom, equation 12.4 gives the expression to determine the energies of different energy states, but then this equation requires the radius r of the electron orbit. To calculate r, Bohr's second postulate about the angular momentum of the electron, the quantization condition is used. The angular momentum L is given by L equals to mvr. Bohr's second postulate of the quantization, equation 12.11, says that the allowed values of the angular momentum are integral multiple of the h by 2 pi. Ln equals to mvnrn equals to nh by 2 pi, where n is an integer, rn is the radius of the nth possible orbit, and vn is the speed of the moving electron in the nth orbit. The allowed orbits are numbered 1, 2, 3 according to the values of the n, which is called the principal quantum number of the orbit. From equation 12.3, the relation between the Vn and Rn is Vn equals to e to the power e upon under root 4 pi epsilon naught m Rn. Combining it with the equation 12.13, we get the following expressions for Vn and Rn. Vn equals to 1 by n into e square by 4 pi epsilon naught into 1 by h by 2 pi, and Rn equals to n square h square 4 pi epsilon naught upon m into 2 pi into e square. Equation 12.14 depicts that the orbital speed in the nth orbit falls by a factor of n. Using equation 12.15, the size of the innermost orbit n equals to 1 can be obtained as r1 equals to h square epsilon naught upon pi m e square. This is called the Bohr's orbit, represented by the symbol a naught. Thus a naught equals to h square epsilon naught upon pi m e square. Substitution of values of h, m, epsilon naught and e gives a naught equals to 5.29 into 10 to the power minus 11 meter. From equation 12.15, it can also be seen that the radii of the orbits increase as n square. The total energy of the electron in the stationary states of the hydrogen atom can be obtained by the substituting the values of orbital radius in equation 12.4 as En equals to minus e square into m into 2 pi square into e square by 8 pi epsilon naught n square into h square into 4 pi epsilon naught, or En equals to minus m e to the power 4 upon 8 n square epsilon naught square h square. Substituting values, equation 12.17 yields En equals to minus 2.18 into 10 to the power minus 18 upon n square joule. Atomic energies are often expressed in electron volts EV rather than the joules. Since 1 electron volt 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule, equation 12.18 can be rewritten as En equals to minus 13.6 by n square EV. The negative sign of the total energy of an electron moving in an orbit means that the electron is bound with the nucleus. Energy will thus be required to remove the electron from the hydrogen atom to a distance infinitely far away from its nucleus or proton in hydrogen atom. The derivation of equation 12.17 to 12.19 involves the assumptions that the electronic orbits are circular. Though orbits under inverse square force are in general elliptical, planets move in elliptical orbits under the inverse square gravitational force of the Sun. However, it was shown by the German physicist Arnold Sommerfeld that when the restriction of the circular orbit is relaxed, These equations continue to hold even for elliptic orbits. Orbit versus a state orbital picture of electron in an atom. We are introduced to the Bohr model of the atom one time or other in the course of physics. This model has its place in the history of the quantum mechanics and particularly in explaining the structure of the atom. It has become a milestone since Bohr introduced and revolutionary idea of definite energy orbits for the electrons, contrary to the classical picture requiring the accelerating particle to radiate. Bohr also introduced the idea of quantization of angular momentum of electrons moving in definite orbits. Thus, it was a semi-classical picture of the structure of atom. Now, with the development of the quantum mechanics, we have a better understanding of the structure of atom. Solutions of the Schrödinger wave equation assign a wave-like description to the electrons bound in an atom due to attractive forces of the protons. An orbit of the electron in the Bohr model is the circular path of the motion of an electron around this nucleus. But according to the quantum mechanics, we cannot associate a definite path with the motion of the electrons in an atom. We can only talk about the probability of the finding electron in a certain region of the space around the nucleus. This probability can be inferred from one electron wave function called orbital. This function depends only on the coordinates of the electron. It is therefore essential that we understand the subtle differences that exist in the two models. First, Bohr model is valid for only one electron atoms or ions. An energy value assigned to each orbit depends on the principal quantum number n in this model. We know that energy associated with a stationary state of an electron depends on n only. For one electron atoms or ions, for a multi-electron atom or ion, this is not true. The solution of the Schrödinger wave equation obtained for hydrogen-like atoms, ions, called the wave function, gives information about the probability of the finding an electron in various regions around the nucleus. This orbital has no resemblance whatsoever with the orbit defined for an electron in the Bohr orbit, in the Bohr model. 12.4.1 Energy levels. The energy of an atom is the largest negative value when its electron is revolving in an orbit closest to the nucleus, that is the one for which n equals to 1. For n equals to 2, 3, the absolute value of the energy E is smaller. Hence, the energy is progressively larger in the outer orbits. The lowest state of the atom, called the ground state, is that the lowest energy with the electron revolving in the orbit of the smallest radius, the Bohr's radius A0. The energy of this state, n equals to 1, E1 is a minus 13.6 electron volt. Therefore, the minimum energy required to free the electron from the ground state of the hydrogen atom is 13.6 electron volt. It is called the ionization energy of the hydrogen atom. This prediction of the Bohr's model is in the excellent agreement with the experimental value of ionization energy. At room temperature, most of the hydrogen atoms are in the ground state. When a hydrogen atom receives energy by processes such as electron collisions, the atom may acquire sufficient energy to raise the electron to higher energy states. The atom is then said to be in an excited state. From equation 12.19, for n equals to 2, the energy E2 is minus 3.4 electron volt. It means that the energy required to excite an electron in the hydrogen atom to its first excited state is an energy equal to E2 minus E1, that is equals to minus 3.4 electron volt minus, in bracket, minus 13.6 electron volt equals to 10.2 electron volt. Similarly, E3, equals to minus 1.51 electron volt, and E3 minus E1 that is equals to 12.09 electron volt. Or to excite the hydrogen atom from its ground state N equals to 1 to second excited state N equals to 3, 12.09 electron volt energy is required, and so on. From these excited states, the energy can then fall back to a state of the lower energy, emitting a photon in the process. Thus, as the excitation of the hydrogen atom increases, that is, as the N increases, the value of minimum energy required to free the electron from the excited atom decreases. The energy level diagram for the stationary states of the hydrogen atom computed from equation 12.19 is given in the figure 12.8. The principal quantum number N labels the stationary states in the ascending order of energy. In this diagram, the highest energy state corresponds to the N equals to infinity in the equation 12.19 and has an energy of 0 electron volt. This is the energy of the atom when the electron is completely removed, R equals to infinity, from the nucleus and is at rest. Observe now the energies of the excited states come closer and closer together as N increases. Frank Hertz experiment. The existence of discrete energy levels in an atom was directly verified in 1940 by James Frank and Gustav Hertz. They studied the spectrum of mercury vapor when electrons having different kinetic energies passed through the vapor. The electron energy was varied by subjecting the electrons to electric fields of varying strength. The electrons collide with the mercury atoms and can transfer energy to the mercury atoms. This can only happen when the energy of the electron is higher than the energy difference between the energy level of the Hg occupied by an electron and a higher unoccupied level. For instance, the difference between an occupied energy level of the Hg and higher unoccupied level is 4.9 electron volt. If an electron of energy of 4.9 electron volt or more passes through the mercury, an electron in the mercury atom can absorb energy from the bombarding electron and get excited to a higher level. The colliding electrons' kinetic energy would reduce by this amount. The excited electron would subsequently fall back to the ground state by the emission of the radiation. The wavelength of the emitted radiation is lambda equals to Hc by E. That is equals to 6.625 into 10 to the power minus 34 into 3 into 10 to the power 8 upon 4.9 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. That is equals to 253 nanometer. By direct measurement, Frank and Hertz found that the emission spectrum of the mercury has a line corresponding to this wavelength. For this experimental verification of the Bohr's basic ideas of the discrete energy levels in the atoms and the process of the photon emission, Frank and Hertz were awarded as Nobel Prize in 1925. 12.5, the line spectra of the hydrogen atom. According to the third postulate of the Bohr's model, when an atom makes a transition from higher energy state with the quantum number N initial to the lower energy state with the quantum number N final, where N initial is greater than the N final, the difference of the energy is carried away by a photon of frequency V such that H mu that is equals to En initial minus En final. Using the equation 12.16 for Enf and Eni, we get H mu If equals to Me to the power 4 upon 8 epsilon naught square into H square into in bracket 1 by N final square minus 1 by N initial square, or mu If equals to Me to the power 4 upon 8 epsilon naught square into H cube into 1 by N final square minus 1 by N initial square. Equation 12.21 is a Rydberg formula for the spectrum of the hydrogen atom. In this relation, if we take n final equals to 2 and n initial equals to 3, 4, 5, it reduces to form similar equation 12.10 for the Balmer series. The Rydberg constant R is readily identified to be R equals to m e to the power 4 upon 8 epsilon naught square h cube into c. If we insert the values of various constants in the equation 12.23, we get R equals to 1.03 into 10 to the power 7 per meter. This is the value very close to the value 1.097 into 10 to the power 7 per meter obtained from the empirical Balmer formula. This agreement between the theoretical and the experimental values of the Rydberg constant provided a direct and striking confirmation of the Bohr's model. Since both NF and NI are the integers, this immediately shows that in transitions between the different atomic levels, light is radiated in various discrete frequencies. For hydrogen spectrum, the Balmer formula corresponds to the N final equals to 2 and N initial equals to 3, 4, 5, etc. The results of the Bohr's model suggested the presence of the other series of the spectra for hydrogen atom, those corresponding to the transitions resulting from N final equals to 1 and N initial equals to 2, 3, etc. N final equals to 3 and N initial equals to 4, 5, etc. and so on. Such series were identified in the course of the spectroscopic investigations and are known as Lyman, Balmer, Paschen, Brackett and Fern series. The electronic transitions corresponding to these series are shown in the figure 12.9. The various lines in the atomic spectra are produced when electrons jump from higher energy state to the lower energy state and photons are emitted. These spectral lines are called emission lines. But when an atom absorbs a photon that has precisely the same energy needed by the electron in the lower energy state to make the transitions to a higher energy state, the process is called absorption. Thus, if photons with the continuous range of the frequencies pass through a rarefied gas and then are analyzed with a spectrometer, a series of the dark spectral absorption lines appear in the continuous spectrum. The dark lines indicate the frequencies that have been absorbed by the atoms of the gas. The explanation of the hydrogen atom spectrum provided by the Bohr's model was a brilliant achievement, which greatly stimulated progress towards the modern quantum theory. In 1922, Bohr was awarded Nobel Prize in Physics. 12.6 De Broglie's explanation of Bohr's second postulate of quantization. Of all the postulates Bohr made in this model of the atom, perhaps the most puzzling in his second postulate. It states that the angular momentum of the electron orbiting around the nucleus is quantized, that is ln equals to nh by 2 pi, where n equals to 1, 2, 3. Why should the angular momentum have only these values that are integral multiples of h by 2 pi? The French physicist Louis de Broglie explained this puzzle in 1923, 10 years after Bohr proposed his model. We studied in chapter 11 about the de Broglie hypothesis that the material particles such as electrons also have a wave nature. C.J. Davison and L.H. Germer later experimentally verified the wave nature of the electrons in 1927. Louis de Broglie argued that an electron in its circular orbit as proposed by the Bohr must be seen as a particle wave. In analogy to waves traveling on a string, particle waves too can lead to standing waves under resonant conditions. From chapter 15 of the class 11 physics textbook, we know that when a string is plucked, a vast number of the wavelengths are excited. However, only those wavelengths survive which have nodes at the ends and form the standing wave in the string. It means that in a string, standing waves are formed when the total distance traveled by the wave down the string and back is one wavelength, two wavelength, or any integral number of wavelength. Waves with the other wavelengths interfere with themselves upon reflection and their amplitudes weakly drop to zero. For an electron moving in the nth circular orbit of the radius Rn, the total distance is the circumference of the orbit 2 pi Rn, thus 2 pi Rn equals to n lambda, where n equals to 1 to 3. Figure 12.10 illustrates a standing particle wave on a circular orbit for n equals to 4, that is 2 pi Rn equals to 4 lambda, where lambda is the de Broglie wavelength of the electron moving in the nth orbit. From chapter 11, we have lambda equals to h by p, where p is the magnitude of the electron's momentum. If the speed of the electron is much less than the speed of the light, the momentum is mvn. Thus, lambda equals to h by mvn. From equation 12.24, we have 2 pi Rn equals to nh by mvn, or mvn Rn equals to nh by 2 pi. This is the quantum condition proposed by the Bohr for angular momentum of the electron. In the section 12.5, we saw that this equation is the basis of explaining the discrete orbits and the energy levels in the hydrogen atom. Thus, de Broglie hypothesis provided the explanation for Bohr's second postulate for the quantization of the angular momentum of the orbiting electron. The quantized electron orbits and energy states are due to the wave nature of the electron, and only resonant standing waves can persist. Bohr's model involving classical trajectory picture planet like electron orbiting the nucleus correctly predicts the gross feature of the hydrogenic atoms, in particular the frequencies of the radiation emitted or selectively absorbed. This model, however, has many limitations. Some are: the Bohr model is applicable to the hydrogenic atoms. It cannot be extended even to mere two electron atoms such as helium. The analysis of the atoms with more than one electron was attempted on the lines of the Bohr's model for the hydrogenic atoms, but did not meet with any success. Difficulty lies in the fact that each electron interacts not only with the positively charged nucleus but also with the all other electrons. The formulation of Bohr's model involves electrical force between the positively charged nucleus and electron. It does not include the electrical forces between electrons, which necessarily appear in multi-electron atoms. 2. While the Bohr's model correctly predicts the frequencies of the light emitted by the hydrogenic atoms, the model is unable to explain the relative intensities of the frequencies in the spectrum. In emission spectrum of the hydrogen, some of the visible frequencies have weak intensity, others strong. Why? Experimental observations depict that some transitions are more favored than others. Bohr's model is unable to account for the intensity variations. Bohr's model presents an elegant picture of an atom and cannot be generalized to complex atoms. For complex atoms, we have to use a new and radical theory based on the quantum mechanics, which provides a more complete picture of the atomic structure. Laser light. Imagine a crowded market, a place, or a railway platform with people entering a gate and going towards all directions. These footsteps are random and there is no phase correlation between them. On the other hand, think of a large number of the soldiers in a regulated march. Their footsteps are very well correlated. See figure here. This is similar to the difference between the light emitted by an ordinary source like a candle or a bulb and that emitted by a laser. The acronym LASER stands for the light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. Since its development in 1960, it has entered into all areas of the science and technology. It has found applications in physics, chemistry, biology, medicine, surgery, engineering, etc. There are now low power lasers with a power of 0.5 milliwatt called pencil lasers, which serve as pointers. These are also lasers of different power suitable for delicate surgery of eye or glands in the stomach. Finally, there are lasers which can cut or weld steel. Light is emitted from a source in the form of the packets of the waves. Light coming out from the ordinary source contains a mixture of the many wavelengths. There is also no phase relation between the various waves. Therefore, such light, even if it is passed through an aperture, spreads very fast and the beam size increases rapidly with the distance. In case of the laser light, the wavelength of each packet is almost the same. Also, the average length of the packet of the waves is much larger. This means that there is a better phase correlation over a longer duration of time. This results in reducing the divergence of a laser beam substantially. If there are n atoms in a source, each emitting light with the intensity I, then the total intensity produced by the ordinary source is proportional to n I, whereas in a laser source, it is proportional to n square I. Considering that n is very large, we see that the light from a laser can be much stronger than that from an ordinary source. When astronauts of the Apollo missions visited the moon, they placed a mirror on its surface facing the Earth. Then a scientist on the Earth sent a strong laser beam, which was reflected by the mirror on the moon and received back on the Earth. The size of the reflected laser beam and the time taken for the round trip were measured. This allowed a very accurate determination of an extremely small divergence of the laser beam and the distance of the moon from the Earth. Chapter completed. If you like this video, please like, share and subscribe to my channel to get more videos. Thank you.